Hi, good morning all. Today we'll discuss about ratio analysis, one of the important sections of CMA part 2. Ratio analysis enables us to understand the financial status, efficiency, the leverage, debt to equity, and the market analysis what we perform here in this unit. This unit is purely on formula based, so we need to know some formula and we need to remember the formula as well. Hi, welcome. Let's begin ratio analysis. The financial analysis, the first part is ratio analysis. Ratio analysis covers almost 25% of syllabus, including financial statement analysis. In addition to ratio analysis, we will have some financial statement analysis, which we'll discuss after some time after completing the ratio analysis. So we are in this unit, which covers around 25% weightage, but not ratio analysis alone. We have some more few small topics. Plus ratio analysis will help you to get a weightage up to 25% of the total 100%. In ratio analysis, we are going to apply a formulae, pure formulae. So there is no compromise. You need to practice and memorize the formulae. Approximately, we are going to use 40 formulae. So try to memorize approximately 40 formulae to become strong in this unit, and it will be a base for your passing mark. In ratio analysis, we'll be discussing about liquidity ratios, leverage or capital structure ratios, which are also called as solvency ratios. Then we will conduct an efficiency analysis by calculating activity ratios. These are also called as efficiency ratios. Then we move on to profitability analysis by calculating profitability ratios, purely the information collected from the income statement. Then the last analysis, it is for corporate companies wherein the shares are traded in stock exchanges. We conduct a market analysis or proprietary analysis in which we calculate market ratios. So to remember easily this ratio analysis topic, you classify the ratios into 5 portions. In liquidity analysis, it tells us about short-term financial position, whether the company is in a good position to pay off its current obligations, current requirements on time, or it get delayed. In long-term, what is the financial position of a company? We can learn it from, we can know it from the leverage ratios and capital structure ratios. How efficiently the business activities are carried out, whether all the assets used in the business are effectively managed or not, that we will come to know by studying the efficiency analysis by calculating activity ratios. How profitable the business is on the sales, on the amount invested, that we will come to know in the profitability analysis. Whether our company is making our shareholders happy as per the market analysis by calculating, this will come to know by calculating market ratio or proprietary ratios. Now we are in liquidity analysis. In liquidity analysis, we calculate liquidity ratios, which will help us to know whether the company is in a position to pay its current obligations or not. Current obligation means the amounts which are to be paid in a short period of time. Like you have some regular payments, like what? Rent, your operating expenses like rent, printing, stationery, electricity, water, telephone, salaries, okay, advertisement, etc. Not only this, you purchased goods on credit to sell them on credit, you know, or cash. So whether the suppliers are paid on time or not, whether taxes are paid on time or not, whether the interest on bank loans is paid or not, or paid on time or not. So we question that whether we have cash balances to pay these amounts on time or not. If we are maintaining good amount of cash balances to pay all these on time, we can say that our liquidity position is good. We are able to pay our obligations on time. So liquidity ratios explain us the ability of a company to meet or to pay its current obligations, short-term obligations, not less more than a year. Obligation means it's a requirement. It's a requirement of cash to pay in short period, maximum period of 1 year. So any amount which is due within 1 year, maybe a day or two, a month, a quarter, but maximum period of 1 year, not greater than 1 year. All these amounts are to be paid from the short-term cash resources. So in liquidity analysis, we calculate first of all a working capital. For this, let me recall our current assets. Current assets we learn using a term called CMAIP. Just remember CMAIP to know the total current assets. C for cash and bank balances, M for marketable securities, nothing but short-term investments made by us, A for accounts receivable, I for inventory, means stock, closing stock, P for any prepayments paid for future period, like next month rent paid now, complete year insurance is paid now. So these are all the current assets, CMAIP, current assets. Cash and bank balances, marketable securities, accounts receivable, inventory and prepayments, which we show on the balance sheet, statement of financial position. Then we have current liabilities. Current liabilities include our supplier balances, which we call it as accounts payable. Any accrued expenses. Accrued expenses means the prior period amount not paid. Prior period means last month expenses still not paid. Like next month expenses paid, it becomes current asset. Last month expenses not paid, last quarter expenses not paid, or last year expenses still not paid will come under accrued expenses. Accounts payable, accrued expenses, any incomes received in advance. Incomes received in advance means next quarter rent we receive now, next quarter commission we receive now, or we did not deliver the goods but we received money, okay, from our customers. Any taxes due not yet paid. Short-term loans, we call it as STL, short-term loans, a quarterly loan, half-yearly loan, which is becoming due. Bank overdraft, a loan taken from bank on daily basis is called as bank overdraft. Then any current portion of long-term loan, current portion of LTL, long-term loan. current portion of long-term loan. Say for example, we have taken 3 million loan with 3 annual installments. Each year 1 million we pay. Okay. In this year, we took this 3 million loan with an agreement that we will pay in 3 annual installments. So this portion will become current liability, which is becoming due. This 2 million amount of loan should be treated as long-term loan. Next year, this will become current liability. The remaining 1 million will become long-term liability. So, need to have an aggregate amount of current assets and current liabilities to start liquidity analysis. So, here we know now what are current assets, what are current liabilities. Now, working capital. Working capital is the amount which is used in the business for day-to-day operations of the business. So, all the working days you need money for various transactions. You cannot postpone some payments. Okay. Therefore, what you need to do is you need to know the requirement for a day, requirement for a week, requirement of cash for a month. By comparing the current liabilities total amount with current assets. Working capital, to calculate working capital, you subtract current liabilities from the total of current assets. This working capital preferably should be positive. If it is negative, means your suppliers are calling for payment and you are hiding yourself because amount is not enough. It is a negative working capital. Current liabilities are greater than current assets, which is not a good sign. Your liquidity is not a good. So supplier may not give you goods later, or you are not paying salaries on time, not paying electricity bill on time, taxes on time. These are all very risky to the company. So that's the reason why you need to calculate working capital well in advance. A working capital is classified into gross working capital and net working capital. Gross working capital is nothing but the total of current assets. CMAIP. Total of cash, marketable securities, accounts receivable, inventory and prepayment will give you gross working capital. We use only net working capital in our analysis. Please remember, working capital or net working capital both are same, which is the difference between current assets and current liabilities. So, working capital or net working capital equals to current assets minus current liabilities. Gross working capital means only just current assets. Let us only talk about net working capital, which tells us that whether our company has positive working capital or negative working capital. Gross working capital tells us only what is the total amount of current assets we have, whereas net working capital tells us what is the positive working capital we have here, that is total of current assets minus total of current liabilities. Net working capital is to be used in our analysis, which tells us that whether we are in good position to pay our requirements on time or not. Then the next ratio is current ratio. After you calculate working capital, the next ratio to calculate is current ratio. First of all, what is ratio? Ratio is a number expressed in terms of the other. Okay. Say for example, this is the amount expressed in terms of the total of this. We call it as ratio. One number is expressed in terms of the other. A ratio can be expressed in fractions. Okay, 2.5 is to 1, example, or 2 times like 2 times more than, you know, like that. Or days, like 45 days credit sales, can also be expressed in percentage, like 80%. So a ratio can be expressed in decimals, fractions, or even you can say 2 divided by 3, okay, 2 times 45 days or in percentage. Depending upon the analysis what we have, our expression will be. So here we express the ratios in like 2:1, means 2 times here over this we have. If this is A and if this is B, A is 2 times of B. You can also write A divided by B. A is called numerator and B is called denominator. A is called numerator and B is called denominator. Current ratio tells us that what amount of current assets we have in comparison with current liabilities. Okay, whereas when you say current assets, okay, minus current liabilities, it will give us working capital. But it tells us only whether we have a positive working capital or negative working capital. Remember, even if you have $1 extra, it still gives you positive working capital. In current assets, if you have $1 extra, it will give you positive working capital. It doesn't justify. Sometimes we need more money here. Why? Because your current assets include CMAIP, like inventory. It takes time to, you know, sell and collect money to pay your current liabilities. Who will wait for that time? Your prepayment, you paid for the future period, you cannot expect cash. So inventory and prepayments, you can't expect cash in near time. But you are including here to find out working capital by deducting current liabilities. So working capital alone does not help you to comment on liquidity analysis. Therefore, what you need to do is you need to calculate a ratio called current ratio. Current ratio explains that what amount of current assets you have in terms of current liabilities. Current assets divided by current liabilities. Remember, CMA IP divided by CL. CMA IP divided by CL. This, okay, you don't care, but the CMA IP, you please follow. 5 components here. When you take all the 5 components divided by CL, will give you current ratio. The standard norm of this ratio is 2:1. The acceptable norm of this ratio is 2:1. Means what? You need to have $2 of current assets against $1 of requirement in current liabilities. So 2:1 is nothing but 2 divided by 1. Current assets divided by current liabilities. I just want to tell you one thing. It is related to all the ratios, not only just current ratio. When you say numerator and denominator, the ratio equals to, you will get ratio, right? Just write down these 4 points. Number 1, if numerator increases, ratio will increase. Okay, if numerator decreases, ratio will decrease. It's just a mathematical expression. No, it's not a particular calculation about current ratio or thing. It's common for everything. Denominator increases, ratio decreases. Then 4th point will be, denominator decreases, ratio increases. It's a number game. Okay, just note down these 4 points. You may have some calculations, questions based on this. And also one 5th point, stating that equal change, equal change in current assets or numerator ratio does not change. I'm just putting R in box. It means that, okay, say for example, current assets, CMAIP, we collected from our customer, cash balance will increase, accounts receivable balance will decrease. See, equal change is taking place only in numerator. Only in numerator, if you have a change in either current assets or current liabilities, ratio does not change. So the basic things just you need to know before we go for the calculations. Okay, at the moment, current assets divided by current liabilities will give you current ratio, which tells us that if it is say 2.5:1, nothing but 2.5/1 means every $1 of current liability, you have $2.5 of current asset. So I can say that your current financial position is good. Okay, but there is an issue in current assets. Say for example, let me write the formula for current ratio: CMAIP divided by CL. So what's happening here? To pay this current liabilities, you are using the total money of all five components. Cash, readily available. Marketable securities, it's a short-term investment, you can convert back into cash. Accounts receivable, your customer balances, you can collect it faster. But inventory. Inventory, first of all, it is to be sold. It may be sold on credit. Okay? And you have to collect. So after 30 days, you sold to a customer and you gave, say, 15 days credit period. So total, it will be converted back into cash in 45 days. But you are also taking inventory to pay your current liabilities. Isn't it? So that's the reason why you have to be conservative in maintaining the liquidity. Means maintaining the cash balances. That's the reason why quick ratio eliminates the inventory and prepayments. We do not consider inventory and prepayments in quick ratio. Otherwise, formula remains same. So, from CMAIP, we are going to eliminate I and P. Same formula, but this I and P is going to be, both are going to be eliminated. So, the formula is going to be CMA divided by CL. The standard norm of this ratio is 1:1. 1:1. That is CMA divided by CL. The answer should be 1:1. If it is greater, it is good. Okay, means $1 of current asset you have here. Okay, to meet your $1 of requirement. Means it's a good position. Okay. Then cash ratio. This ratio is more conservative than quick ratio. I want to tell you one more thing. This quick ratio is also known as asset test ratio. In some questions, you may find the other name as asset test ratio. Quick ratio or asset test ratio, both are same. Okay. So quick ratio or asset test ratio does not consider the inventory and prepayments. And the standard norm of this ratio is 1:1. Cash ratio. Cash ratio is more conservative than quick ratio. Means what? We want fast cash. We cannot wait. Say in my previous example, for quick ratio, we considered CMA to pay current liabilities. But this accounts receivable may give you some, you know, may request you some time. I'll pay after 1 week, 1 month, like that. So you cannot convince your suppliers, like taxes, electricity bill, okay, salaries, etc. You cannot, isn't it? So that's the reason why you need to see that what my position, if I do not consider this accounts receivable as well. See, the formula is becoming more and more and more sharper. Remember, current ratio, CMA IP divided by CL, means we considered all the current assets. The moment we eliminated inventory and prepayments, it has become quick ratio. Okay, and now we are even eliminating the accounts receivable as well, because it may take some time. So we don't want to take risk from our suppliers. That's the reason why we are more conservative here by calculating cash ratio, by even eliminating accounts receivable. So easy to recall is, every time like you want, you become more conservative, you remove this, you know, the items. CMAIP is the original formula to calculate current ratio. I and P are removed, you get quick ratio. A is removed, you get cash ratio. This norm of this ratio is 0.5:1. Means if you have a requirement of $1, you can maintain with the 50 cents. Cash and cash equivalents, that is cash only here, and marketable securities. This is M. So C plus M from current assets divided by current liabilities. Just to recall, so far we calculated working capital by comparing the current assets with current liabilities, whether we have positive working capital or negative working capital. Current ratio, to know the total amount of current assets in terms of current liabilities. Quick ratio, to be more conservative, we removed inventory and prepayments, and we know the liquidity. And more conservative is cash ratio, wherein we take only near cash items by eliminating even accounts receivable. Working capital should be always positive. Current ratio, it should be at least 2:1. Quick ratio should be at least 1:1. And cash ratio at least 0.5:1. Then the next ratio is cash flow ratio. For this, just I want to recall one of the financial statements, cash flow. Remember cash flow? Cash flow has three sections. Our cash flow statement has three sections. Cash flows from operating activities, cash flows from investing activities, cash flows from financing activities. The real cash from your operations, core operations of the business, daily buying, selling the goods, buying and selling the goods, buying and selling the goods, what cash you generated is called as operating cash flow. Cash flows from operating activities. Whereas this amount you will receive by selling of investments or company's fixed assets. This is not from core operations of the business. You receive cash here by borrowing money from banks or by selling the shares of our company. Okay, but from the operations of the business, daily operations of the business, what amount of cash you receive is called as cash flow from operating activities. Cash flow from operating activities, whether this amount is enough to pay our current liabilities, or we have to sell any asset to pay current liabilities, or we have to borrow money to pay current liabilities. This is not a good sign. When you are purchasing and selling the inventory goods on regular basis, that money should be enough to pay your current liabilities. Why should we sell our company building to pay current liabilities? Why should we borrow some more money to pay electricity bill of the office? It should be from the sale of goods, right? So that is what explained by a cash flow. ratio. A cash flow ratio says that how much cash you received from the operations of the business to meet our current liabilities. So the cash which is generated from operations of the business always should be much enough to pay current liabilities. Not only that, the cash generated from operations is say 5 million. Your current obligations are say 3 million. Still have 2 million. Now you can say what to do with this money. Now you can decide, say company is having any rental vehicles you can buy, or company has loans you can repay them, or company is running in rented premises. Okay, you can have your own premises. It should be like that, but not the other way. So what I mean to say is this should be greater than this. When numerator is greater than denominator, so ratio will be greater than 1, right? So the standard norm of this ratio is always the cash flow should be greater than 1. How much greater? As much as possible. So more cash you generate from your operations, more good. Why? Because this amount after the payment of your current liabilities will be used to acquire the asset, to expand the business, to repay the loans previously taken. So it shouldn't be less than 1. If it is less than 1, what happens here? We'll have to borrow money to pay liabilities, or we have to sell our assets to pay liabilities. It's not a good sign. Clear? So working capital, current ratio, quick ratio, cash ratio, cash flow ratios. These ratios help us to understand a company's short-term financial position. So if you are in a credit department evaluating your customer's short-term financial position, you are a banker and a customer is requesting to give you loan, first before you give loan, you will check this position. Okay, so you are in credit department and you want to give credit to the customers, but before that you analyze customer's financial position from his, you know, balance sheet. This shows us the liquidity position of a company. Now the next ratio is net working capital ratio. Net working capital ratio is nothing but the working capital in terms of the total assets. On your balance sheet, you have current assets, fixed assets. Current assets, fixed assets. I'm just preparing a T balance sheet for to you understand. Current assets plus fixed asset will give you total assets. Likewise, you have current liabilities, long-term liabilities, and owner's funds, that is shareholder's equity. Okay, the total is equity and liabilities. So these are the amounts. When we compare current assets with the current liabilities, we call it as working capital, current ratio, quick ratio, cash ratio, and cash flow ratio. Okay, now we are calculating the net working capital in terms of the total asset. So here we have total assets, current assets and fixed assets. In terms of what? Current assets minus current liabilities. Means what amount of working capital we are maintaining in our company in terms of total assets. Okay, so we can see that what is the working capital we are maintaining in terms of the total assets. What was it last year? What is it current year? Or what was it for our competitor? What is it in our company? So we can compare our performance with others' performance. Whether we are heavily maintaining the working capital in terms of current assets or low. Okay. So net working capital divided by total asset should be efficiently managed. I cannot say that this should be this much, like two times, three times, or like that. No, we have to manage efficiently. We have to manage efficiently. Okay, it may be a less than one also. It may be less than one also. Why? Because this is total asset. Total asset is a denominator. If you have denominator greater than numerator, you will get less than one. Say for example, 50 divided 10 divided by 50. It will give you point how much? 2. It's less than 1. Whereas 100 divided by 50, it will give you 2. Okay. So it may be less than 1. But how efficiently you manage is a different thing. Okay. If you manage very less amount in net working capital as to total current assets, it may be a problem to the company. Okay. So company may not be able to pay its obligations on time. That's the reason why you need to see that how the company is able to manage its liabilities from the current assets, whether we are able to pay salaries on time, taxes on time, whether we are able to pay our suppliers on time. What happens if your supplier account is delayed? What happens if there is a short-term loan from bank is due next month, but we don't have any money? We are yet to pay salaries, or 2 months electricity bills are not paid. So it's all, you know, very, very difficult to run the business if the company faces any low liquidity issues. Means liquidity is not enough. And this is what we studied in liquidity analysis. Let me show you a balance sheet. Mostly you will see 2 years balance sheet. 2 years balance sheet. And in this, it's supposed to be year two is supposed to be this side. Mostly you will have year two first column, year one next. This is current year and this is previous year. Just assume that this has to go here. Okay. And in most of the questions, you don't expect inventory and prepayments also. If given, okay, fine. If not given, always remember CMA IP in current asset, but may or may not be there, or prepayments may not be there. Okay. All right. Now we have current assets, C, trading securities here, M, marketable securities, A, accounts receivable, I, inventories. What is missing here? Prepayments. No issues. The total current asset is 715,665. Current year, 665. Last year, 715. Supposed to be this column, supposed to be here. Okay, fine. Now, they have some investments as well. 350, 300. Then fixed assets. Then goodwill, etc. The total assets are 2,615 last year. 2,450 this year. Current liabilities, total are given. Sometimes in the exercises, you will get totals like this. You don't need to take a total again. Long-term liabilities, then stockholders, shareholders' equity. The total of current asset and fixed asset should match with current liabilities, long-term liabilities, and shareholders' equity. That is this. Okay. Now just only assume that these are the amounts we are going to use to calculate, you know, working capital. Okay. So to calculate working capital of say year one, what should we take here? Current assets of year one, total current assets 715, total current liabilities, that is 695 minus 695, so 20,000. Second year, 665,000 minus current liabilities 700,000. Working capital is negative, minus 35, which is bad. Okay, so this way you need to calculate from the given information about working capital, current ratio, etc. Now let us calculate current ratio, which is also known as working capital ratio, but do not follow this working capital ratio, please, because we have a ratio called working capital turnover ratio. I prefer not to follow this name. I prefer not to follow this name, working capital ratio. Prefer use current ratio. Current ratio for year one, if you take year two and year one, year two, we had current assets of 715 over current liabilities 695, giving you 1.03. What does it mean? For every $1 of current liability, we have $1.03 of, you know, current assets, which is not good. In fact, why? Because we said 2:1, right? And last year, year one, 665 current assets, 700. Oh my God, it was very less. It is even less than one. So it is very difficult for this company to meet current obligations. Why? Because if you need $1, you have 95 cents. If you need $1,000, you have $950. Okay. Whereas for this this type of company, say for example, in the scenario in the exam, he may give you that industry average, means what other companies follow in the same line of business. If this is a manufacturing industry, of electronic goods, and it is given in the exercise that the industry average means what others follow in the same line of business is 1.5. Nowhere we are standing here. So the liquidity position of this company as per the current ratio is too poor. So the banks may not like this position. Suppliers may not like. So in that case, what happens is these people do not get any credit from the suppliers. So you'll have to improve the current ratio by having more current assets. Asset test ratio. Asset test ratio is also known as quick ratio. What difference we have here is we eliminate inventory and repayments. We have current assets of 715 from which you need to deduct inventory portion. What is the inventory portion here? Inventory portion 275 and 290. So 715, okay? 715 is the current asset and we'll have to remove inventory. Or else you can take cash, marketable securities and receivables divided by current liabilities. It is 1.03. And year one, it is 0.95. For this ratio, industry average is 0.8. As far as this ratio is concerned, it is okay. We have 1.03 and last year it is 0.95. Which indicates that the company is okay to meet the very sharp payments are met on time. Cash ratio. Cash ratio even eliminates this accounts receivable. Means 50 plus 75 divided by 695. 35 plus 65 divided by 700. Should be like that. Cash ratio, cash equivalents plus marketable securities. So it is 0.18 here, 0.14. 0.818 and 0.14. Okay. This is the end of session today. We'll learn some advanced topics tomorrow, and have a good day.